welcome back inside our Proactive Newsroom. And joining me now is Bernard Tourillon. He's the CEO of HPQ Silicon. And Bernard, it's good to see you. How are you?
Very well, very well. On a snowy day in Montreal.
Nice. Well, it's good to have a snowy day in Montreal, as they say. And the good news is that you've had some really interesting news come out recently. We'll get to that in just a second. But just give us a bit of a background on HPQ Silicon.
Well, HPQ Silicon is a clean tech company developing, basically developing new ways of making industrial products that are needed for the renewable energy revolution that's ongoing. And our goal is to develop basically low carbon process to doing things that everybody needs. And we focus more on the material called silicon, SI, in the periodic table, because it's one of those sandwich material that is used in everything. Okay, so you cannot have a computer chip without having that. You can have a solar panel, all those ingredients needed. But it's a material that, because it's sandwich, has no way of being recycling. You can't recycle really silicon. So you have to do the first production of it. So you end up with needing new processes to meet the demand and cleaner processes. So that's one of our primary focus. Our secondary one is fumed silica. But you know, if I start going on all the things we're working on, we will be spending most of the interview on it.
Yeah. So there's obviously a pretty big need for silicon. Is that what you're saying? That you're providing a big need out there?
Our timing is could not be better, in the sense that we've been working at this and developing this technology since 2015-16. Originally, we were looking at a niche market of doing a metallurgic route to make solar grade silicon metal. But what happened in the last 12 months has completely changed the dynamic. You have to understand that silicon manufacturing is a dirty industrial process. So it was offshore, mostly to China. And now people are realizing that, if we want to reshore, chip manufacturing, we'll need to have a capacity to make silicon the raw ingredient. Now, the reason why the manufacturing of silicon or fumed silica was basically, offshore outside North America or Europe was because it's a very polluting process. So people don't want dirty smelters next to them. We, with PyroGenesis, have invented a smaller, scalable, cleaner process of doing it. So we can address much more of the social acceptability. We have a very, very green process to do our material. And it's scalable by much smaller increments. So our footprint that we will put down is smaller. And by default, our capital requirement to do it will be smaller.
Yeah. So you just had a news release out in cooperation with PyroGenesis about this Gen 3 PUREVA quartz reactor reduction reactor. So explain to us what this is. And I know there's been some testing in order to get the pilot plant up and running.
Yes. Well, what is the PUREVA really? It's a new way of doing manufacturing that incorporates two concepts. One of them is being able to operate under vacuum. When the heated material is under vacuum, it's easier to remove some of the impurities that are a problem with silicon. And the second one is to be able to operate in a basically an inert state for the entire time of the process. Those were the two really big technological advances that we've demonstrated with our primary step, at laboratory or even at proof of commercial scalability test, small machine. It's almost possible to do anything. Yeah. The issue becomes once you're going to commercial scale, and that's really where I would say, 100% or 90% of the companies that try to do what we're doing get into trouble. That's the reason why also I partner with PyroGenesis. PyroGenesis will not get involved into a project unless they see a pathways to commercial scalability. And what we've announced a week ago, fundamentally, was that the scaling up of the most technically challenging part, okay? It's a 2,500 times scaling up from our lab scale in our previous generation. So that's a massive scaling up. You don't do that at commercial scale. And the two most important capacity of the system, which is being able to operate under vacuum and then keep the system under inert state for a long period of time, we're talking multiple days, we've achieved these goals. So what's left for us to do now is sort of like easier, because it's the same thing that a traditional smelter does. You put the quartz, you put the reductant, you put the heat, the reaction occurs, because it's quartz, SiO2, So the O2 with the SI goes with the carbon and creates carbon gases that are, you know, removed. And the silicone is put in a liquid form and then it's poured out. So that's a very well-known part of the process.
Okay.
What was it? What was the big unknown was, could we do the two things that we've done in Gen 1 and Gen 2 that allowed us to do something that nobody in the world can do, which is start with a purity feedstock of X and go with a higher end product purity. Okay. In the industry, you need extremely pure feedstock to make lower quality, and then you need to add multiple purification steps. Just to give you an idea, the battery space is going to require 3 to 4N material. A traditional smelter can barely do 2N. So if my competitor wants to do silicone for battery material, he has two technology routes to do. Either he does acid leaching and cleaning of its material, which is an expensive process to do, an environmentally dangerous one, or they use rapid solidification process, but that doesn't give you as pure as a material. Our process, on the other hand, okay, we should be able to make it. That's the next big milestone that we are hoping to attain. We should be able to make 4N material, 3N to 4N, in one step. So what that means is what comes out of our reactor is already battery grade material.
Right. And so when, so how long are you looking at timeline for that? Because obviously you, now that the pilot plant is ready to process this material. So what is that going to be the next step into the end of this year and the next year to try and get that done?
Yes. What we're doing now, because it's still an R&D, you know, it's a state-of-the-art prototype, it's an R&D machine, steps are going to go, we're going through what we call 4 process improvement tests. So during those tests, we're going to make silicone, so we'll have raw material. We'll figure out what are the last tweak that we need to do with the system, okay? And once we've done those 4 tests, beginning of next year, we will start operating the system 24/7 for, I think, 2-3 weeks. So then we will have all the information required for us to start looking at scaling it up. And once that is done, then we'll know how everything costs. And then we'll take a look at what's the next business strategy to develop. But the key point is, from the moment we start the process improvement or improvement test, which could be, you know, anytime, it's very hard to give a timeline because we're so close to it. It's very soon. You know, from anytime we will be making material, and then we'll be working with our other R&D team internally to make, you know, battery grade material to make silicon nitrate. What we're looking at HPQ is focus on niche market, which is going to bring you to 10,000 to 20,000 ton per year demand of material, okay, that have very high selling price, okay, but that my competitor, the traditional one, for them is very difficult to attack for the very simple reason. They make 500,000 ton a year of silicone, okay? A market that's 20,000 ton for them is very specific to do, doesn't change anything of their bottom line, but for HPQ can be very profitable.
Okay. All right. Well, it sounds like it's interesting. We look forward to continuing to follow the story for sure. Bernard, thank you so much. Good to talk to you.
Thank you.
All right. There's Bernard Tourillon. He's the CEO of HPQ Silicon.